real quick, obviously before we get started, just so that you understand the format for today, so we're going to go through the four different projects that you guys were asked to do. While you're going through the projects, expect that I'm going to probably interrupt you. I'm going to ask questions. I'm going to make comments. Please don't take anything personally. This is meant to be a constructive learning experience. So, you know, sometimes you're going to think, oh my God, he's out to get me. That's not the point. It's all about trying to go through the process and help you to better understand maybe what you're missing and what potentially can be included or should have been included or should have been thought about, that sort of thing. So with that, we're going to go ahead and get started with the presentations. Now, obviously, you guys that are watching the other groups certainly feel welcome to jump in and ask questions and make comments as well. And with that, let's go ahead and get started.
Okay. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We're group one. You, Marielle and Natasha, we're going to be discussing a leasing opportunity number one. Currently, this is a commercial use at Agricultural Arts. The building size right now is 2,300 square feet. And we'd like to improve that and make that become 4,600 square feet. Our acquisition cost would be $782,046, with a construction cost of $717,028, and the total project cost will be $1,499,674.12.
We're asked to identify what type of tenant we'd like to attract, and we kind of did it like just a benefit of adding a second floor, which is how we ended up at 4,600 square feet. And basically a daycare, they need 35 square foot per child, and so we calculated that we'd be able to offer them a bigger space so they can have more students, and then ultimately, you could charge them a better rate per month. We went into our construction loan. It's a simple construction loan of 6% interest rate for 12 months. This is an example of our construction loan. So we kind of did a comparison. This is where we analyzed what rent we would need to ask for. The first one is in the case where we actually did go on and do the construction, and then the second one is where we wouldn't take on the construction cost.
Here's our pro forma. What we do with our rent per square feet, we want to kind of give ourselves a cushion because we know on the other slide we need at least 21 to charge at least $21 per square feet for support the project to be feasible. So what we did, we chose to do $25 per square feet with the increase of the construction going up to 4,600 square feet for the particular building. And what we did, we broke it down because we are not going to actually be the tenant that's going to be in the building. We put zero in as our operating expense because we're not operating a business from out of it. That would be on the tenant. As far as the vacancy rate, because the building is a small building, it's just going to be like a daycare. It's only one tenant. So we're not looking at a vacancy rate as far as a percent, because only one tenant. We're not looking at multiple tenants. So we put the zero there as well. And so we broke it down here. At the $25 per square feet at 4,600 square feet, we had a potential gross income of $115,000. With no other income or vacancy, that made the gross income the same amount. For our annual debt service, we based that off the loan that we had there. So we took the loan amount. Once we did our loan schedule for the mortgage or what we need for the project, we took that payment amount and multiplied it by 12 to get our annual debt service. And this is what our before tax cash flow would be. And here, what we want to do, we want to try to hold the property for about 5 years, whatnot, get that tenant a chance to build their business before we sell it. And what we did for the selling price, or what I did for the selling price to see what the price would be with the improvement, I did an average of their net operating income for those 5 years divided by the projected cap rate from the previous slide, and that gave us a value of the property to be at $1,915.72.
the mortgage, we use the 70% of the actual cost of the project for the loan amount. 6% interest rate, holding 25 amortization period. And then you can see here our scheduled payments and the total interest paid and some of the fees that were applied to our loan. And then Natasha's going to explain to you our analysis of the whole project and what we came about the conclusion of our project.
What we have here is this is what the property appraisal valued the property at $942,000. But what we did, what I did with the projected value, I took what the last sale price was of that particular property, and also took the amount of square foot for the land. What we computed was the square foot for the building. But we looked up on the property appraisal site to see how much square foot is for the land, and multiplied by, I think it was $7 that they was doing for the land. So I added that cost with the last sale price that they did for that particular property to do a projected value of what the improvements to be at the $1,915,000. The property, the building itself was doubled in size. And the current rent rate for that particular area was currently at like $16.94. But we figured with the improvement and that area is going to redevelopment, we can actually increase that rent rate because it's going to have a different look to it. So that's why we went the proposed rent rate of $25. And the current selling rate for those particular in that particular area was $290 to $369 per square foot. And for our proposed purchase rate, we're purchasing at the $301 per square feet. But with the improvement, we feel we can sell it at a higher per square feet rate of $416.
So we've improved on the building. We just repositioned it so we can attract a better tenant. And we concluded that it would be feasible for us to do a second floor, and it would probably be beneficial in the long run as far as our return. And then we would only hold on to the permanent loan for 5 years.
Are there any questions?
Okay, so let's just start with this slide. Okay. You've got the current rent rate in that area of $16.94.
Yes.
And I heard your explanation as to saying that, okay, you know, the area is redeveloping and we're going to be able to get $25 a square foot. I mean, how realistic do you really think that is?
For the $25 per square foot?
Yeah, because, I mean, you've already said in your analysis, I mean, if we take everything that you've done at this point at face value, you need to get about, what was it, $21 or something
yes.
like that per square foot in order for your project to be feasible. So the $21 a square foot is already, you know, $4 or $5 above the current normal rent rate. So how can you, in good conscience, justify this?
What we was looking at, because we actually went to take a look at the particular area. Currently, it's like what they call it, like in the bad part of the neighborhood with the demographics. But we figured with the redevelopment, it's going to kind of change the demographics
okay,
a little bit.
So how long is that going to take?
That we have not discussed.
Well, I mean, that's obviously, wouldn't you think that would be an important thing to consider? Because my suspicion is that's not like a year. That's not necessarily even 2 years. That could be 5 years, could be 10 years, you know, for that sort of redevelopment, repositioning, and the improvement of that market. I mean, you know, there are plenty of other alternatives for people to potentially choose. So, you know, it's not as if there's a shortage of space, you know. So, you know, I'm not seeing a compelling reason as to why you can justify the $25 a square foot.
I went to City Hall and I spoke to people in the planning department, and they're very optimistic that.
Well, sure they are.
Yeah. Well, that's what we basically went by.
Yeah, I mean, you know, everybody wants to be optimistic, but, you know, optimism is not reality. I mean, reality is, if the current market rent rates are $16.94, then, you know, you're being overly optimistic about what you can achieve.
That area has been depressed for a really long time, and now the change is coming about, and they basically told us that, you know, rental rates basically is going to really.
There's one other thing that we have to consider, also Dr. Forty, is that this property is owned by the CRA, and if we qualify for their assistance, basically they're willing to pay a 10% on the cost of the project, and kind of act as a buffer so that we can attract this tenant. And that's why we picked the daycare, because we feel like they would fall into that category, and then the CRA would be willing to help us reduce our costs, and then maybe we can ask for a lower rental.
Yeah, but even so, I mean, I guess, okay, I'm just going to have to agree to disagree, because I just don't see how you can, in a world of reality, because you're talking about $25 versus, let's say, $17, that's like a 40-something, almost 50-something percent difference, you know, in the cost there. So to me, I don't see it. I mean, you know, I understand. See, this is one of the most common mistakes that people make whenever they look at projects is they try to make it work. You know, that's not your role. Your role is as the investor, you know, trying to see what is reasonable, what is rational, what is possible. You know, if it were me, at first glance, not, you know, even getting into to some of the other detail, I would have said, okay, if it had come back at $21 a square foot was my required cost, I probably would have just tossed this one aside. Because if the market rent is $17 a square foot, it doesn't even make sense for me to even consider it further. Okay? All right, let's go back to your very first slide, where you had some of your assumptions. Okay, the next one, actually. All right, so here you talked a little bit about the number of students that you could have, or the number of kids that you could have in the space. So 131 students. So did you back into, in essence, what the cost per student would be per day?
We did, but we didn't put it in the slide.
Because it looks to me that your cost of occupancy, your rent that you're wanting to charge these folks would be about, what, $9,000 a month? Isn't that what you said, roughly? You got 118,000 or something is your, well, one of the slides you did. You had 97,000 on that one, but I thought another one you had.
115.
Or 115,000. So 115,000, basically, this is do simple math, divided by 365 days in a year, so it'd be $315 a day that you've got to come up with out of pocket as the owner operator. So that's, let's say, about $3 a student. I mean, do you think that, I mean, how much do people pay for daycare per hour?
Per hour?
Or in other words, 131 students, I mean, how many?
Because I know they charge about 300 or so per month for a kid.
Okay, so 300 per month per kid, so you back $30 a day. Okay, all right, and in terms of your staffing, in terms of other costs, I mean, do you think that that's a reasonable ratio?
We didn't go that detail into it, so I mean, not you know, think about that way. 25 might be a little too high. What we was looking at, that the $17 was what, like I said, is what it is, would have been like a, and not an attractive location per se, but we figured with the redevelopment that we can actually go to an increased price.
So, you know, a lot of this is also predicated on this whole business of you being able to add a second floor to the property. Okay, so did you investigate whether that was even a possibility, whether the city would...
Yes, they were willing to entertain it.
Okay. And the way the building is currently configured, is do you think that it's fairly viable to be able to do that in terms of the type of roof system that is in place with the building?
Just to reinforce the roof and keep building, but yes.
Because my suspicion is, I mean, you know, once again, I haven't actually seen the building, but looking from the picture, you know, it's a question of what type of roof that they have. If they have a wood roof, whether they have a steel reinforced roof, and whether or not that, you know, current roof is going to be able to even come anywhere close to being able to support a second floor. You know, if it wasn't built with that intention in mind, then chances are you're potentially going to have to remove that, you know, completely and almost start from scratch. So it's, I mean, that's another aspect of this, you know, and also just this configuration of the building. I mean, you know, in terms of access to the second floor, I mean, my suspicion is you'd also have of problems with American Disabilities Act, because how are they going to get to that second floor? You're going to have an elevator.
Yeah, they're not that expensive. They're not.
For that size of a building, it probably doesn't make a whole lot of sense, though.
I mean, we went to development sites where it actually had elevators in apartments.
Right.
In Pembroke Pines.
But those are residential elevators, not commercial elevators. It's a big difference.
Oh, okay.
Residential elevators, yeah, you can get those $25,000, $30,000, but a commercial elevator that has to go through the annual inspection process and the size requirements are much different, much more expensive.
You're right, Dr. Corgi, and we appreciate that input, because we were trying to analyze the two, whether we could build it, whether it would be worth it, and your feedback does reassure us that it maybe we were being way too optimistic, considering the square footage and everything and the possibility to construct. But all in all, this was a good learning experience for us.
So even in consideration what you just said, just looking from this slide here, because without the extra floor, doing that cabinet like $22, so we can actually be able to potentially lower that amount as well, because we don't have that construction cost going into.
Right.
We have to need that extra money, per se, to cover costs. So the $22 can probably be a little bit lower, kind of closer to the market rate, because we're not putting in the cost of construction.
So your construction cost,
it's like $700,000 was the construction cost.
Which also seems a bit excessive. $304 a square foot. That's why you said $700,000 for construction, correct?
Yes, that's what the construction cost.
And you're adding basically 2,300 square feet or so forth, if you have $304 a square foot, which seems kind of high.
Yeah,
so even if we don't do the second floor, I think then with that way we can actually back that rental rate down closer to the market rate, to where it won't be so expensive for the tenant.
This is the second floor.
I just want to say one thing. It looks good, the construction draws, but I think usually the beginning of the project, there's like a larger draw.
Yep, that was, you were reading my mind. And not only that, but I mean, there are a number of sources that you could have potentially access to try to get a more accurate distribution of your construction costs, to try to, instead of just having in essence, a fixed amount each month, potentially, look at the when the dispersions are actually, or dispersions are actually happening. And I think PC is correct that a lot of those are going to be upfront, which is going to drive up your cost of borrowing, because your interest costs are going to be higher. Okay. So what was your source? I don't see any citations. I mean, remember, if you remember, one of the things that I asked for were citations for all of your sources. So where's your citations for your interest rates, for your cap rates, for your market information?
The cap rate came from the CoStar program.
I don't have it.
The only thing that I have studied is the daycare. The interest rate, she spoke with one of her friends that's in the mortgage business, but the cap rate and the rental rate that came from CoStar, and the sell price, it was like I stated before, came from the Broward County's appraisal site.
And
so we didn't put that.
The construction cost per square foot, that was actually high. I think I applied it to both floors instead of just the second floor, because it was supposed to be only $150 per square foot, and we're thinking, even we had that source from a lead magazine, so it told us what the square foot was for that.
This goes for all the teams, that you need to show where you're getting this information. You know, anytime you put something like this together, that someone from the outside has no clue as to where you're coming up with these, sort of assumptions. And, all of that needs to be stated. I mean, I'm not asking for it in some sort of proper APA sort of format, but just simply, here's where this number is coming from. And so there's some sense of realism attached to it, and it's not just, you know, I just make the assumption that you're just pulling it out of the air. Okay, all right. Anybody else, any other questions? Okay, thank you. Team number two. You may have to switch it back over to the desktop. Up on the switch thing up there.
Yeah.
Because I think they switched it over to laptop mode.
Yeah, I'll once okay. I have it up, right?
Gotcha.
Yeah, you said laptop, right?
No, it should be on desktop.
Oh, well, PC.
There we go.
All right, so my name is Alan Grant. This is Luis Mendez and Boise Calendar. We are KLD, where we will be presenting a leasing opportunity for a commercial office space on the ground floor of the City Vista apartment building. So I'll be discussing about the market trends and the national forecast for the Pompano sub-market area. Discussing more about the type of tenants that would be an ideal fit for the commercial space on the ground floor. And about the opportunities with that lease. Whereas Luis will be talking about the construction loan and the permanent financing. And then Cressy will discuss about the pro forma balance sheet and the conclusion. So what the market looks like for office space. So right now, Fort Lauderdale is in at a area of expansion provided by this draft by Mueller. And what I mean about in the terms of expansion, right now, in the Pompano Beach submarket, they have expanded their total leasable office space for Class A. In the Class A office market space, they have increased it by 87,000 square feet, whereas in the Class B office market space, they've increased by 128,000. And for comps within the market, there were two Class B buildings which provided similar comps in terms of square footage of the land property for the site. And with that, the market rates were between 16 and 19. Though given we were looking for a Class A tenant with triple net leasing, we're looking to have closer to the given rate of $27 per square foot a year. And the tenants, so with this space, the Pompano Beach Community Redevelopment Agency would like to utilize it as a co-working space to enhance the communal atmosphere within this area. So given that, I looked what the industry was like, was for the co-working industry. So I called the local office located in West Palm Beach, talking to one of their representatives, telling them what the co-working market is like. So the average desk space size is about 131 square feet. When I say desk space, it's about the area where one individual will be utilizing the space for him or herself. And then for the number of members meaning the number of individuals working within the co-working space for each desk space will be about 1.61. Given those metrics, we were able to identify what the income would be for this tenant space. Be about $26,000 plus per month, given the net leasable area of 3,300 square feet with 24 desks. So can I give an idea of what this area is like? So the 3,302 square feet will be on the ground floor of the new apartment building, which is being developed and will be delivered at March of next year. It was purchased for $1.3 million for 2.41 acres. But it was also important to note that while the net leasable area is, the gross leasable area is 3,302, the net leasable area is 3,800.
Okay, now I'm going to be talking about the construction loan. We had a few conversations with Brian Cab Funding Group, and they agreed to give us an interest rate of 5% on the construction loan. And the total construction loan is going to be $646,000. That's $170 per square foot of construction times 3,800 square foot, which is the space that we're going to be developing and building. If those $170 are based on the assumption that we're going to be using the best construction techniques and material, and also we're going to be hiring a project management and a permit expediter, those salaries and fees are included in that. Those expenses are going to be included in the total construction loan cost as well. So Brian Cap was, they gave us an LTV of 70% with a term length of 12 months, 5%, as I just said. They need a permanent financing before the 12 month, but in case we don't secure permanent financing, they're able to give us a mini perm up to 2 years, so we can have more time to find permanent financing. The land acquisition cost $19,500. That's the price that the ground floor area cost in terms of the total land. Basically, we got that number from the sales price of the land divided by 250,000 square feet, which is the total area of the land, times 3,800 square feet, which is the gross leasable square feet that we're going to build. So, okay, now let's go to permanent financing. In the permanent financing, we discussed the loan terms with the PNC Bank. The way they calculated the interest rate was the following. It's going to be a 6-month LIBOR benchmark. Last time I saw them, the 6-month LIBOR was 1.36, so that's why I put it in the presentation. Plus a 4% loan margin, that comes to a total of 5.36%. It's going to be a 30-year amortization loan with monthly payments. The balloon payment is made on year 10, so we have to refinance or sell by the end of the 10th year. The origination fee is 1%, and the prepayment penalty fee comes out to 1.3%. They require a debt service coverage ratio of 1.3, and after we calculated on all the interest, our effective cost of borrowing was 5.5%. And our monthly payment is going to be $3,850.55. Okay. Now Quest is going to explain the performance.
All right, the performance. As my colleagues were telling, is that the rent, the average rental rate for the area is $2,716. In year one, we're going to do a net of $103,208. There's no operating income because it's a triple net lease that we can lease the space to CRA, and then we're going to sublease it out to the co-working tenants. But I know that service is based on the 1% minimum of 1.3. But if we go back to the mortgage model, can you go back to the real please? See that the actual debt service is going to be a lot less than the 1.3, so there's some claim there. If we change this to 2.23, which is the actual DCR, which is the debt service ratio, this figure, the actual before tax cash flow is $56,000. We can get that number, Professor. Start answering questions. The actual before tax cash ratio is 56,926.39. When we were doing this project, you were asking also about the value of the property, and we came up with the value of the property by dividing the net operating income by the market cap rate for the area. Is 6.75, so that would be 1.529 million is the value of the property. That's the terminal value of the property when we sell it after we develop it. The going in value of the property, which is the going in rate, without a discount, is going to be 1.2 million. And I arrived at 1.2 million by taking the net operating income for the year and divided by 12, and taking 103, 208, and 15 divided by 0.15, which is the actual cap rate going in. And that gives me the construction and income approach value. And then we take the IRR, the 56,926, and divide it by that, by the 688. And that gives me the projected net present value is $885,996
going in. We don't have a slide for that?
I don't, but I can write it all so it makes it easier.
No, let me go.
So the IRR is 56 at the 15% cap rate. 56,926.30. None. So we use the 103, 208 divided by 0.15, the cap rate, and we get 688,053133. And then we do the formula on the calculator to get the net present value of the going in net present value after construction. It's going to be 688,053.33. It's after the term of the 5 years. We use a 5 year term. The end of 5 years because the cash flow is 5 years. I didn't go up to 10 years. I just did the 5 years. So we do 5 shift N. And then the payment on the that we use. The monthly payment of the annual debt service for the 1.3 debt service coverage ratio, that would be 8600.66 PMT, and then hit the present value key, and it brings you to 1.204. 1.204092.93. So that is the value going in without the discount. If we discounted, I did a discounted rate of 8%, and that brought me to 885,999.66. So the terminal actual cap is 6.9, but the going in is 15%. We arrive at all of that based on the income approach.
I don't know why you're using the debt service as your payment, because you're making the assumption, unless I'm just trying to follow what you've right. done, but you're saying the value of the property currently is worth 1.2 million with all of the cash flows.
So right, you're saying discount, correct?
But why would you be using the debt service to calculate the current value of the property? That's an expenditure, not an income stream. Your income stream off the property is the before-tax cash flow.
Right. Why don't we use the strict NOI divided by the market rate, cap rate for the Class A? Right. Came up to 1.5, so I'll just...
Yeah, but that's using NOI. That's right. That's income.
Right.
And that's assuming all cash. But if you're actually using the debt and assuming that the debt is an actual cost, and then the cash flow stream you're going to be using is the before tax cash flow, and you're going to be using your equity.
Right.
And you're mixing and matching is basically what you're doing. Okay. All right, let's move past that. All right, so, what do we have after this? Anything?
So the income approach, we got a value of 1.529. The market value approach is 1,000,064. We got that based on the price per square foot in the area, which was $280 per square foot in the area.
And it didn't potentially give you any pause to just notice that much of a difference between the two?
Yeah, I did notice the difference between the two.
And do you have any reason as to why there might be that much of a difference? That possibly your calculations for the income approach are totally wrong?
I don't think it would be wrong. The only thing that may be wrong would be the market cap rate for the area, which is 6.75, is what we got from CoStar.
Okay.
So that cap rate was based on the
CoStar
Star rating, where they have instead of like class A, B, and C, they have a star rating from 1 through 5.
Right.
And based on that, what the similarities would be between class A, based on my assumption, 4 and 5, based on the quality of the material for the construction, the service and amenities that are provided.
Yeah, right, I get all that.
So.
But okay, look, if I'm hearing what you said, you calculated the market value approach by doing what? You took basically what the average value was per square foot in the market multiplied by the square footage of your building, correct? Okay. With the income approach, you took what in your mind was the appropriate net operating income and the appropriate cap rate and came up with that value.
Correct.
Okay. To me, that's the big red flag, because there should not be that much of a difference between, I mean, the income approach and the market value approach if you indeed did what you said you did. So that, to me, what that implies is on the income approach, you probably were too generous with your income, or potentially your cap rate was potentially off. Okay, it's got to be pretty much one of the two, or both.
Well, the problem that we have in that area is that you're not a lot of class A buildings.
Okay, I understand that. But my suspicion is that you're being overly generous with your income. Okay, go back to the very beginning with your first set of assumptions on the space. Okay. All right, right there. Okay, there should be one thing that pops out in that table above all else.
The vacancy rate.
The vacancy rate. 21%. That's huge.
We didn't anticipate that because we have a tenant, already tenant.
Okay, now, if you already have a tenant, sure, okay, you can maybe discount that somewhat. But, that having been said, chances are, if you've already got a tenant, you may not be able to achieve that stated rental rate up there of the $27 a square foot. More than likely, it's going to be, you know, something a little bit less than that. To have that tenant already kind of locked in and ready to go. So chances are the rental rate that you've got there is probably a little bit ambitious for the space that you've actually are trying to lease out. Or, you know, another component of this is maybe you're underestimating some of your costs. Okay, go forward a slide or two here. All right, whoops, let's go, let's see, yeah. Okay, so one of the things that you said that you did was you took the land, you took a look at what it sold for of the $1.3 million, and in essence, you took and you said, okay, there's 250,000 square feet within the total property, and you sort of divided that $1.3 million by the 250,000 square feet.
Right.
So the base assumption that you make there is that all space within the building is equal. It's not, okay? Your first floor space is gonna be worth a lot of money because it's on the first floor and it's the easily accessible commercial space, which is probably going to have a substantially higher value per square foot than the residential space on the upper floors. And even with the residential space, I mean, any of you that have ever leased apartments or condos within buildings that are more than, you know, one or two stories, there's usually a premium paid on what? The higher floors, you know? So, you know, that's something that, you know, should have been taken into consideration is that ground floor space could very well be, you know, worth dramatically more per square foot than that residential space.
Oh, it definitely can.
Yeah, we talked about doing adjustments.
And not only that, but usually the construction cost for a mixed-use facility is going to be a little bit higher than just a single-use facility because that ground floor commercial space is held to commercial standards, which tend to be higher than the standards that are that the residential space gets held to. And the fireproofing and a whole number of other things that sometimes have to be done to that space. Now, the other thing that you did which I'm glad that you did, is that you attempted to sort of condominiumize that space, which was the intention, was to sort of say, okay, we're going to sort of carve this space out and treat it as if it's a separate property. I think that that is the appropriate way to look at this.
Yeah, we actually talked to a GC, and he was the one that gave us the $170 per square foot of construction.
But now there's another aspect to this that you, I wasn't clear on. You were talking about that you're leasing this out to this co-working space.
Yes.
And they are going to be charging $26,000 a month for the rental of the space, is that correct?
Yes. So
you're staying there, yes?
Yeah.
Now, who is paying for the finish out for that space? The $171 a square foot that you quoted, my assumption is that's pretty much the raw space with ceilings, walls, maybe air conditioning systems, that sort of thing. But the co-working space is going to have all of the sort of physical infrastructure necessary for the co-working environment.
Yeah, that price is taking the building improvements and some of the tenant improvements. In terms of finishes, it's only taking around 50 or 60%. You know, it depends on what the tenant wants to have in the inside space.
Yeah, because with a co-working space, it's mainly with these given tenant operators for co-working space, these spaces, they're trying to be more premium finishes.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And they're trying to expand more into new areas, given that this...
I love the concept. I'm not arguing the concept. What I'm arguing
in terms of the
is
cost yes.
up front, because that there's going to be a fairly heavy investment per square foot for
and
the furnishings.
For the build-out. There are several structures in terms of what I came across, what the leasing structures are between the operator for the space and the owner of the whole
okay,
property.
So go back. What is it you're charging the tenant for the space?
It would be the Class A rent for the area.
Okay. So they're charging the differential. So in essence, it sounds as if they're really paying for their own finish out, unless you, I'm not seeing where you've inherently incorporated that into your analysis. Now also, doing the math on this, it looks like per desk, the price that each one of those people would be paying would be a little over $1,000 a person, like $1,083 or something like that, I think was what I calculated. Now, my experience with co-working space here within in Broward, significantly less than that per person. So that seems a bit high. And I'm just kind of wondering.
What some of the metrics were utilized? Because one of the difficult things of obtaining some of the metrics, like the revenue and cost structure, was that they had like revenues by location as one metric, or revenue by the number of members for a space. It's usually the case that the bigger the space, especially for co-working, the more revenue they can draw in. But the thing is, there's also kind of like a correlation in terms of the office location where like the population is.
Right.
So if the co-working space is in with a million plus, they can draw usually generate more income of 70,000 plus based on the DeskMag global survey that I came across.
Yeah, I'm not arguing that the concept is a bad concept. What I'm arguing is Pompano Beach an area that you would expect to find premium pricing for co-working space?
This space is located on the southernmost portion of Pompano Beach, rather close to the Fort Lauderdale market, listed by CoStar, it would probably give kind of like an extended boundary
from tenants looking at Port Lauderdale, to look at the Pompano Beach within a new development with the ease of access from I-95. And with the future development of the tri-rail expansion along the Florida East Coast Railway, which will be situated close to the downtown Pompano Beach development.
Okay.
But of course, that's an optimistic viewpoint.
Yeah. Because, I mean, once again, from the pricing I've seen on most co-working spaces, I mean, even with a fully enclosed office, I mean, once again, they're small, but, I mean, I've seen, and I mean, really nice ones, they're $600 a month, fully enclosed for one person, and what you're describing, you know, over $1,000, it just, I don't know, it just seems a bit excessive.
Yeah, given that it would be overvalued in that sense. Just kind of curious though, based on what, on your input, the $600 per desk, would you know the gross leasable area of that space, what the average would be? Because it's the average office space for co-working is about 10,000 square foot.
Yeah, but this is obviously a much smaller space than normal.
And of course, it's not, given that the Pompano Beach Community Redevelopment Agency would be the one managing the lease for the space, my assumption would be that they're not as, have a incentive for the space to be for profit, more or less to give intangible benefit to the community. Because co-working space is not just about, I should not say that, it's not just about the profit that would be drawn in or revenue for the tenant. It can also be providing a communal space for, based on given demographics. It could be for graphic designers, it could be for young professionals, which they're trying to draw in. Because that's when
I totally agree with the concept. Let me just make sure I'm very clear about that. What I'm arguing is simple, certainly the numbers.
Is that the membership monthly rents, or the monthly membership payments is a bit too high.
Okay. What about parking?
There's no parking requirement for the site.
Okay, but where are the folks going to park? Who's going to pay for it?
CRA is going to I mean, that's off-site improvements, and we're not required to comply with parking space requirements, so we didn't actually take that into consideration in our calculations.
Because, I mean, once again, if you're pitching this to a tenant, you know, they're going to look at their total cost of occupancy, and one of those total costs of occupancy is going to be the parking required.
Right, the CRA is going to provide off-site parking, so I guess when everything's developed, people are going to be able to park on the street and go to the building or to the commercial space, and
right.
That would be, yeah.
Okay, other questions?
Yeah.
No one else? Okay, thank you.
Oh, no, that's not the new one. That's not the new one.
It's my first presentation in a while, so I'll get that out of the way first, but it's about to backtrack a little bit here and there. Sorry, guys.
Our group did the leasing opportunity number 3. I'm Andrea, this is Christian and Kenneth. Information about the property, 3,936 square feet. Market rental rate per square feet for the property is $11. Vacancy rate, 0%. Single tenant, therefore maximum purchase price is $541,200, and the other getting debt cover ratio is 1.3.
And we got that that
material
from
a couple words on that too. The purchase price we came to, we're calculating based on an expected 8% cap rate. That's coming from the fact that in the area, you're looking at about 6 to 7%. We're thinking with a little bit of the risk premium because we don't know exactly where this is gonna go with the CRA, we don't know how it's gonna work. So we figure an 8% is a reasonable cap rate to expect. The market rate we have up there, market rate's actually, we found was a little bit higher towards the 12 to 13 range, but we're hoping to get a triple net tenant in there long-term to do their own build-out. So we took the rent down a little bit there.
So far you're batting 1,000. All right.
Okay, so this is just taken from our loan information. And it for our loan amount, it is 3,000. I mean, so sorry.
I spoke to a lending officer, Mark Zmilichap. He does commercial loans, and he told me we most likely in a project like this, you would get a 65% loan to value. So our loan amount, based on our purchase price of that was $541,200, so 65% loan would be $351,780. He told us 4.75% would be the rate. But between that and 5, but again, to stay conservative, we assume 5% would probably be a better bet. We only have it up to 5 years here because our plan is to get a long-term tenant in. And once we lock the tenant in, after 5 years, we'll sell it and hopefully have a little bit of profit at the end.
Okay, so
This is our before-tax cash flow model. This is our five-year projection. So you can see, based on the rent of $11, our net operating income would start out at $43,296, and that's the number we use to calculate our cap rate. That's our first year, obviously, of NOI. The annual debt service, that's something you might notice. It really could have been based on our loan payments. It could have been a little bit lower, around the $28,000 for annual debt service, because our payments are $23,21. But the lender's offering 1.3 debt coverage ratio. We stay conservative there. So there might be some play for build out.
Conservative is always good.
Okay. This is the cap rate. So this is just showing we expected our 8% cap rate, and we use that to kind of back into the implied value of what this is the max we would pay for. So again, this is conservative. There might be some negotiation. Maybe you can get a little bit lower, and then we'd have a little bit of a better cap rate.
So, yeah, the first year of net income, we divided by 8 and divided by 541.
All right, so we did the net present value of the net rent. And this information right here, these are our cash flows. Based on it going up 3% each year, with the base first year was $11. So we just did the 3% each time it increased. We put in the cash flows, and at the end we were able to find that the present value net rent was $46.42 with an effective net rent of $11.63, and the discount rate, which is our cap rate, was 8%.
This is to give an idea of another option. If we aren't able to get the tenant that we're hoping for to do their own build out, we're obviously going to have to do the build out for them. The structure is, it's this freestanding building, and it's kind of a blank slate right now. There's nothing in there. It's just an open room. So we kind of estimated about a $30,000 build out, putting it into the construction loan model. The total construction loan cost would be $32,000. So again, this kind of backs into what we would ask for if we were to do build out. So,
and what was the type of tenant?
We're leaning towards restaurant type concept, like the CRA had in mind, just because it seems like that's kind of what they're pushing for in that area.
It's like one big open space, and if you go there, there's a lot of people trying to make the neighborhood come up. You know, it's not a good neighborhood over there. So when you go there, that's what they do want, though, is to bring that in. Kind of like what they did with Wynwood, where it's not good, but they bought all those restaurants, breweries, bars, all of that stuff. So that's honestly what we're looking for, especially because the back area has a big patio area. Like, it's just a big lot of empty grass that if we, in the case study part of it, it tells you that they want to build on that. So hopefully, at some point, you know, that can be used as an outdoor space, especially if you have like a bar or a brewery.
So where did you get the $32,000 for the construction cost for the space? How did you come to that number?
We chose $30,000 as a total, just based on, it's close to 4,000 square feet. $10 a square foot we seemed like that would be reasonable, because it really is just, we were able to take pictures of the inside, yep. And it's really just flooring and drywall that's...
Right. But the problem, I mean, that I think you're maybe not overly considering is that it's a restaurant space, what kind of restaurant, because that's going to dictate dramatic differences in your cost because of all the kitchen equipment.
Okay,
Well,
we
much prefer a bar space then.
No food.
Yes, I mean, seriously, that's really going to dictate, you know, whether you're going to install a Venabug, whether you're going to have
a walk-in cooler,
that cost could just go through the roof. But you know, if it's something relatively basic and simple that doesn't really require a lot of cost, I mean, it's possible. It's just that number may be a bit low.
I the equipment part would have missed that, because I know the hoods alone, like you said, the commercial hoods are probably close to 30 grand.
Right.
I mean, hopefully this is just not this is not what we wanted. We just put this in as an option, but we would prefer that the tenant does the build out, not us. Have to come in and do a construction loan. Because it's honestly not that feasible.
Yep.
This is kind of like a analysis of what in a worst case scenario, we don't get a tenant quick enough. So rather than wait around for a speculative tenant, we could offer somebody a build to suit, and the discount we could give them to come in as quickly as possible would be $40,000 over the lease term. No, that's over the lease term. So it would be $8,000 a year. And I think I had that on the paper. I think it was like $10.50.
Yeah, no, I get it. All right, good job.
We did a mortgage equity model, and once again, we just put in all our general information. We used the first year NOI. That's what's in there, and it calculated that with our discount rate, our cap rate of 8%, and the interest rate being 5% with a 20-year loan, the mortgage amount was $425.41, that the mortgage plus equity value was $645.95.
Beautiful.
And this was our exit strategy, which, do you want to explain more?
Sure. Okay, so this is the IRR if we were to sell after 5 years as planned. We're assuming we're going to sell at the same cap rate. Obviously, it'd be better if we sold it at a lower cap rate for us. But we're assuming that it's an 8% cap rate when sold. So the sales price would be $609,125.38. Our loan balance at the end of 5 years is $301,000. So the profit on the sale is about $308,000. So the total IRR would be 15.65%.
Okay.
That's it.
Good. Borrowings with your formatting, I think you did a great job.
Thank you.
I think your assumptions were really right on target. I mean, very conservative. Love it.
Okay, so good morning. We are group four, and we took a look at 11 Northeast 1st Street in Pompano Beach. This is a broad overview to see if it's a project that we would like to pursue further. So we just are giving you a basic overview. Here's the front of the building. It's just a generic.
Yeah, it's I'll jump in real quick. Okay. It's a corner building. Actually, behind us is the railroad tracks. The main street is over to the right-hand side here. We do have a video, so it'll kind of orient you a little more. But this is the front of the building, which is right here. And what the CRA is proposing is this is going to be, they want a restaurant tenant. And they actually built the sidewalks wide enough on both sides so that it can have outdoor seating. So I wanted to point that out in that photo.
And this is the interior of the building at the moment, so it's a good built built to suit.
Yeah, I mean, it's a complete shell. That's dirt floor, so I mean, it's ready for someone to come in and put plumbing and do whatever they want.
Right.
That would be really fun.
Okay, so this is basically the front of the building, and there's a center across the street. It's a market, and it's really packed on Saturdays. It's a nice area to sit out in, and across there is the City Hall building.
And that's the railroad tracks.
The railroad tracks. I-95 is right up the street, and this is our building. Okay, so we felt like the highest and best use for this space would be a restaurant. There's not one in the general area. There's a lot of potential traffic from across the street at City Hall, as well as a convention center. And there's a large Baptist church across on the other side as well, all within walking distance.
The subject property annual rent that was proposed is 73,176. The square footage is 6,098, which is $12 per square foot, plus taxes and insurance. Has a reduced rent incentive, major construction required, with 12 months free rent. So we got sources from CoStar and brokers from Seacoast Bank. After speaking with them, they proposed an action rent in the area for the restaurants was $16 per square foot. And, we said that for CoStar Bank and another broker, Tommy DeMonte, said $15. So between $15 and $16 per square foot for the restaurants in that area.
And that's on a triple net lease.
And actually jump back. Let me add in something right there. So the building itself is owned by a third-party investor. The CRA is actually renting the building from this entity that owns it. The CRA is pushing out a $12 per square foot lease, which is under market because of what it's going to take to get the building up. I mean, you know, they're expecting the tenant to come in and do the construction. And that's also why they're providing 12 months free rent. Okay, now jump to that. Like I said, the guy that bought it, the entity that bought it in 2016. We don't know the actual purchase price, but we do know that it's got a $959,000 mortgage on the property. Like I said, the CRA is leasing it currently. The CRA has a buyout clause to purchase the building, either by the CRA or if someone came and wanted to buy the building for $1.2 million through the CRA. CRA, of course, is providing financial incentives. One that this building qualifies for is both facades, because it's on a corner, qualifies for a $20,000 facade grant. So we get $40,000 check written to have everything done on the outside of the building. And then the CRA will pay 15% of the total construction cost, up to $1 million or $150,000 for a tenant to come in and or if the owner wanted to do the construction.
All right, go to,
yeah.
So the first thing we did in order to, did you have the bank information somewhere in there? One of the slides, I think I saw.
On the Seacoast.
I can talk about the bank, I mean.
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah,
just
so I called one of our alumni at Fifth Third, Mark Patterson, and Seacoast Bank, Julian Moore, spoke with them both. Fifth Third, of course, too large of a bank to actually do the financing on this small deal, and it's a restaurant. So Seacoast, smaller bank, construction loan, 70% loan to value with a debt service cover ratio of 1.25. And 25-year term. And Mark actually said for our proforma to bring into the bank, we should do everything at a 6.5%. He's like, more likelihood you'd get a smaller, in the real world, you would get a smaller interest rate probably from Seacoast. And she actually said it would be like 300 basis points over LIBOR, which would, you know, without going through all the finance and everything. But to do the portfolio at a 6.5%, you know, he wants to see us be conservative. Could be more.
All right, so what we wanted to do in order to analyze this deal and know if we wanted to go forward with it was to figure out.
I'm sorry. How do we get this over?
This thing is messing up. Let me pull it up.
Don't worry about it. I can see you now.
Somebody hit this button. See
exactly. We had to get a recent resolution, but just leave it as it is. That's fine.
If you select the area of the cells and then do
it's
WQ, then you can select that area.
That works fine. Yeah, you good?
I'm good.
Okay.
I'm good. So anyway, in order to figure out, we have to make some assumptions. The first assumption is that the CRA has a buyout clause at $1.2 million. So they will let it go for $1.2 million, and we wanted to see if we could buy it at that price, what are the conditions that we need to have? So, okay. Just clear where it was. I can take it from there. Okay, so at $1.2 million with a 30% equity, we get an $840,000 loan. And when you work through the numbers with a debt coverage ratio of 1.25, you get that we need a minimum square price per square foot of $1,395. So that is our break-even point. We need something at $1,395. So let's go forward, get out of this, and go to the cash flows. Not that one. This one. Or that one, yeah. No, that's not it. The one before. No.
That one.
No. The. The other example. Yes, exactly. That one. Yeah, that one. Okay, so at $1,395, and you want to scroll down? Right there, perfect. So at $1,395, what we did here was that I forced the cells to actually not give me a debt coverage ratio. Not giving a debt coverage ratio of 1.25, but to actually give me the actual annual debt service. So I forced that here, and I got this cash flows at $1,395. Okay? So,
yeah.
Trick. Okay, perfect. So when we go to when we go to the mortgage, just leave it there and scroll. Yeah, I can read it. That's okay. All. So when we go to the actual mortgage capitalization, we get all the cash flows, and we want at least a 20% discount on our money. And the reason is that it's a restaurant business, and those businesses are very risky. So at least we want to get 20%. So in order to pay them 1.2 million or just about, we need to know the assumption that we at least can sell it 5 years later for 1.5, which seems kind of reasonable. You know, we're going from 1.2 to 1.5, and with the cash flows, we can pay them that price. Now, that is assumption number one. That will be the goal. You know, if we can get this, we can do the goal. Now I want to go to the one that it was the fourth one, where you have it. I just want to show you how it works with the no-go. Yeah, there you go. So go to the cash flows here first. Yes. All right. So best case scenario, say we can get $15 a square feet and we can actually discount from that to attract a tenant. Let's say that we, okay, so the previous version was taking it with already a restaurant inside, working and operating, and we are buying it from the CRA at 1.2. Now, the CRA might not want to do that, and if they don't want to do that, we don't want anything to do with it. Now, we said, okay, what if we get it as is, and then we put the tenant? Well, assuming that we can get $15 a square foot, which is kind of that what the actual area is going for, and assuming that now we're gonna give them a year of free rents, plus $190,000 for $40,000 for the sign outside, and we're gonna give them also up to $150,000, our first year cash flow will be negative by $258,000. And then on year two, then we'll start making some money, and this will be the cash flows, okay? Now, when we get that and we put it into the capitalization, and again, we force our mortgage here, we get that, expand that cell there, we get that in order to still make our 20% and pay them the 1.2 million, it means that we will have to assume that we can sell that piece of building for 2 million just 5 years later, which is outrageous. We don't think it's gonna work. So this is our no-go. So the only thing that we can buy this is either with a functioning restaurant at 1.2 with at least a $13.95 rent, or buying it as is, but not for 1.2, for a discount at least equivalent to the $258,000, which would be less than $1 million. So they might not like to do that because they have a mortgage for 959. So it will be basically buying them out at cost. So that is our conclusion. That is what we do when we're investors. Option one, option two. Questions?
So why do you think that the CRA is leasing this from the current owner?
They're trying to redevelop that area. If you actually take a look at that entire area, all of that, well, not all, but about 90% of that whole strip is vacant, and then you go up the side street and all of that is also for
they
lease.
They want to control the tenant to go in.
Right.
They want a restaurant there. That's why.
They have a certain...
Yeah, because they have a plan. So
right.
They have, right now, so you mentioned parking in a previous presentation. So it's all street parking currently. One block over is a public lot, which
mm-hmm.
they, so they're like Diana said, there's no restaurant yet. So as soon as they get three restaurants, then they're gonna have a CRA paid for valet parking service for the restaurants, okay? And then as, you know, 5, 10 years, who knows how long, that lot is actually slated to go to a public parking garage. So I mean, that's why the CRA is leasing. I mean, they're dictating who goes where in their overall plan for them.
Potentially, they can have up to two tenants there,
right.
3,000
yeah.
square feet, but the numbers wouldn't change as far as we're concerned.
And
right.
You could also technically build a second story on that building too, and you could divide that. So you could technically have four tenants if you wanted to, she said. I spoke with Emily
right.
at the CRA, so. But you know, she's like, hey, there's a tri-rail coming in, but they've been talking about it for years. I mean, you can't count on that. The realities are that we're right on a freight railroad, okay? And you know, dining at night, you're gonna have a train going by. Outside seating in Florida on the west side of a building, because the breeze is usually coming off the east, blowing west, so it's gonna be hot.
Yeah.
So,
especially the sun setting
yeah.
in the west.
You gotta sit
right
here.
You're
the first mega church.
Yeah, and you're the first restaurant. So you're pioneering Wildcat. It's not like you're coming in and there's already a restaurant seat. So you're in a cheaper room.
Well, I'm glad that you did what you did with the whole approach of looking at what it would actually cost to do the renovations. And apply this discount, because I think that was really important in the analysis to kind of ferret that out and also kind of get a reasonable estimate of what that first year of lost rent would be and how much of an impact that would be on the project. But no, I think, you know, overall, I mean, I think you guys did a good job.
Thank you.
Okay. So, all right, all those projects aside, what do you think about this whole Pompano for redevelopment effort?
Hey, well, actually, I have some more information.
Okay.
So, they are, it's actually pretty interesting. So, the CRA, the two directors, and I don't know their names, but the one lady that started City Place CRA in West Palm Beach is part of it, is the, one of the directors, and the other, I think it's the gentleman, and I may have him backwards, that started the Delray Atlantic Avenue CRA. So I mean, you have some two heavy hitters with tons of experience. They've assembled a team that's pretty. They've got some degrees and experience. You know, so their team is solid. And what they've done is, or they're planning to do. I don't think they have any of the approvals yet, but they're trying to fashion it kind of after San Antonio. I don't know if any of you have been to San Antonio, but San Antonio has a like a river walk kind of thing. And of course, Amsterdam with all the rivers that they have. And that's what they're actually doing because there's no, within the CRA, there's no place to have water storage and retention. So, you know, they're trying to actually dig canals. They're gonna build dig canals and have higher density because you don't need this water retention anymore. So, I mean, it's pretty interesting if they can get that done. But, you know, we're all in this class and or program. We all kind of know that we're at the top of a market, per se, maybe. So, you know, if it continues for 5 years, it may actually get a head start, but if the market crashes, it's going to be dead for like another 10 years.
Right.
My opinion.
No, I would not disagree. Any other thoughts about it?
I actually have a property in Pompano, close to Intercoastal. Man. That neighborhood is really a blight in Pompano. And both sides of I-95, nothing but drug dealers and gang members and crime. One of my classmates actually ran some studies and found that there's a lot of
sex offenders.
I mean, tons of sex offenders in that neighborhood, and that neighborhood is just dying.
Okay.
One of the brokers that I spoke to, I asked them, both of them, what do they think about the restaurant? They thought it was a great idea, but one of them mentioned, as long as people there, and I mentioned the parking. Said, well, people are gonna have to walk from the parking. Says, and as long as you can create an atmosphere where they're safe, where they feel safe, that they can actually walk. So the area is nice. I didn't visit during a night. During the day, I walked around, and it felt safe, but I don't know at night. And if you cannot get that feeling of being safe in that area, it's gonna be tough. But like Deanna mentioned, there's a church and there's also that they're building a massive art center, mm-hmm. You know, for concerts and things like that, walk away. So.
Mm-hmm.
I have one more.
Yep.
It's funny because when I was talking to these lenders, they told me that they usually don't lend money to developments that are within a 1 mile radius to Martin Luther King roads, because if
really?
You, I mean, they did a research nationwide, and according to them, all the roads that are Martin Luther King are around bad neighborhoods with sex offenders and crimes, so they tend not to lend money in those areas.
Interesting.
I found that funny.
Yeah, that really.
I actually live two blocks in an apartment building, two blocks from this area, and I can't tell you how many times my car got broken into. So for me, I would never, like in my life, go there and go out if it was like a restaurant scene, because I moved away from there because of how it is. But my only thing is that, like, when I think about it, I say that, but I can't tell you how many times I've been to Wynwood where people's cars have been broken into and it's horrible crime rate and all of those things there. So you never know. It's kind of like it could become a popping scene because I would much rather drive to Fort Lauderdale than drive to Miami.
Sure.
So it might end up working out.
Okay. Ken, did you have-
When we were doing some of the research for the project, we looked at the demographics a little bit, and it was in Pompano, I think it was like a 23.9% poverty rate. So they kind of have to make it a destination from outside cities, and I think that's the hurdle, because the people there, they're not going to go to a brewery and spend $8 a beer.
Right.
So I don't know.
I would tend to agree that, you know, that there has to be this whole sort of destination aspect to it, that they really, you know, have to think of the different things that are going to draw people in as a destination until they can get it to the point of where it's the interesting, cool, amazing place that people want to live and you know, work and so forth. So yeah, no, I agree.
Well, given that they're trying to make it a destination point, when they also have a competition, given that the directors and the individuals involved with it, or behind the development for Delray Beach. So, I mean, they only have direct competition with that city at the moment, too.
Oh, sure. Yeah, Delray Beach, there's no question that, I mean, it's a great example of redevelopment, no question. But at the same time, you know, one has to sort of say, well, what they're trying to create, though, is more of an employment hub as well with this area. That's not just an, you know, entertainment district. It's also, you know, going to be an employment hub. So what do you think about, you know, because they're branding, you know, a lot of this the innovation district, you know, and so the idea is to kind of bring in the kind of, you know, that's why I thought you were dead on with the co-working space, because as a tenant type, that is the kind of you know, tenant that you would want, you know, for this space that, you know, hopefully is going to be more accepting of kind of a neighborhood in transition, possibly, because they're a bit more unconventional. So
also,
you know, I think that aspect of it, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, it's a great site for incubator for individuals of different backgrounds to gather and try to set up a startup company too.
Okay.
Piggybacking on what Kirsten said, I think one of the genius of Wingward is that they created first, they started renting to artists.
Yes.
And they created a whole atmosphere where you go once a month to an artist thing where you could walk into all the galleries, and people got comfortable going to Wingwood for the galleries. Then
absolutely,
they brought the food trucks and would go in and out, and then eventually the restaurants. So unless you can create, if they want to create something like innovation, maybe they can bring like artisans.
Yeah.
And then a big, you know, the restaurants might be a long way out.
That's why they had that green market.
Yeah.
Exactly.
No, it's and I think, you know, whether I mentioned in this class or, you know, in other classes, you know, the typical progression of a redevelopment is, you know, once the neighborhood has effectively reached rock bottom, then, you know, usually, you know, if it has potential for whatever reasons, because of close proximity to something else. Like, you know, with Wynwood, obviously it's the close proximity to, you know, downtown. You know, but you know, an area like Pompano, one has to sort of say, well, what is that selling point that you know is going to draw people there? What is it close to? And that one's a bit more of a challenge to sort of, you know, sort of pick up on. But the typical transition is, yeah, you bring in, as you say, the artist, they pay next to nothing in rents. But you start getting the foot traffic, you know,
right,
people coming there and seeing it, experiencing it, and then you start, you know, adding in, as you said, you know, the mobile food trucks, you start adding in live entertainment, you start, you know, sort of going down that path and getting people comfortable, and then all of a sudden everybody says, oh, this is the place I want to hang out, you know,
right,
on a regular consistent basis. Then you start building the housing, people start, you know, living there, and then the rents start escalating, you know, significantly. So those artists that were originally there are priced out and kicked out. No, but it's true. They're priced out and they're kicked out because now all of a sudden they want to build more housing to basically on top of those warehouse spaces. And this is a process that is not unique at all to Wynwood. I mean, this happens all over the world, you know, that you have this sort of redevelopment life cycle that unfortunately a lot of those cool, interesting, unusual sort of tenants that sort of start the process are not there 15, 20 years right. later because they get priced out of the market.
Right. Also, the first Friday of every month, they do have, you know, that's when they're starting their open concerts and food trucks and things like that, which was actually yesterday. But she said, Emily also said that if we wanted to, she would peel out time during that, whatever, 6 to 8, whenever they have it, and walk us through the community and point out what's going on.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it has a lot of potential, but it's just, it's one of those things that you've got to, you know, we've got to begin to think about, you know, what are the attributes that are potentially going to draw people in? What is it about Pompano or in the immediate surroundings that are going to be appealing to, you know, people in all these different ways? And then how are you going to combat, you know, the issues and the perceptions of crime and theft and, you know, all the things that, you know, tend to surround it as well? I mean, that, and that's a tough one to overcome.
They just need to put a school right in the middle of it.
That's an interesting thought. Okay. All right. Anybody else? Other thoughts on it? Okay. All right. All right. So at this point, go ahead and take about a 5-minute break. And what we're going to do is we're going to come back. We're going to do, those of you that are going to do the third test, do the third test. And then I will, after you've done that, then I can give you your current grade in the class. I can also give you current grade in the class without taking the third test. And then if you're happy with that, then you're free to go. But before you go, and you don't have to do it in this room, but make sure you do the course evaluation, if you haven't already, and get that out of the way. So with that, how many, show of hands real quickly, how many of you are planning on doing the third test? Okay.
Next week. Oh wait.
The one today, the third test, not the overall final, just the third test, the one today. Anybody? Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. All right. So the rest of you, my assumption is you're either going to come back next week or you're going to wait and see what the grade is that you end up with. Okay.
And evaluation will be by the 5th.
That is correct, which is 2 days from now. So you need to get them done today. That's right. What I'm saying. Go ahead and just try to get them done today.
And you're going
to
try to start grade right now?
I will give you a grade in 5 minutes. Go. So take a break. Come back.
Congrats.